I feel like a small group leader that's trying to get everybody in the living room. Hey, let's have a meeting together. Welcome to all of our locations, all the campuses. We are so glad to join all of you together here during the two-minute mingle. I hope you're having as much fun at your campus as we are here at Grants Mill. It's been an incredibly powerful service already, and I am so excited. I have been looking forward to tonight since the time that Pastor Chris shared with the lead team who was coming to speak to us. Pastor Chris, by the way, will be back this Sunday, so he's going to be preaching this Sunday. And one of his dear friends, Pastor John Lindell, they've been friends for many, many years. Pastor Chris has been to his church, James River Church, in Springfield, Missouri, a few times, but we have never been able, we've had his entire family here for Grow and different events, but Pastor John has never been to Church of the Highlands. He is an amazing, amazing pastor and leader and father and friend. I mean, an incredible man of God. He's been pastoring James River for 31 years. So come on, we need more of that these days, don't we? And so my faith expectancy has been very high for tonight. And I just would love it if at every campus we could give him his very first welcome, and hopefully not his last, to Pastor John Lindell. Welcome to Church of the Highlands. Welcome to Sweet Home Alabama.
Thank you very much. You may be seated. It's so good to be here and to see Church of the Highlands. You know, y'all are a great church, and a great church does not happen by accident. It happens when God breathes on a place, and it also happens when there's a leader who is seeking the face of God, paying the price to lead people consistently into the presence of God and the will of God for that church and for their lives. You have one of the greatest pastors, and I'm not saying that, you know, in hyperbole. I'm saying it because it's true. Pastor Chris Hodges is a leader of leaders. He is a once in a generation leader, honestly. And I'm so grateful for his influence, for what God has done here, for the way it's strengthened churches across the country. You have no idea. James River's just one of them. And then just simply the kindness of your staff, Pastor Lane and the others who've been so kind to my family and to me. And it's a thrill to be with you tonight. Across the campuses, would you just show Pastor Chris your appreciation? What a great man of God. As Lane said, we pastor in Springfield, Missouri, been there 31 years, and something I never thought would happen is just being able to share life and ministry at this stage with our family. So here's a picture of the troops, and it's somewhere. Okay, there it is. It's right there on the TV. And so it's my son David and Brandon, their wives and kids, my daughter Savannah, and so I got 8 grandkids. And being able to share life and ministry. They all work at the church. The grandkids don't, but they think they do. So we have a lot of fun, and it's just great to be able to do that season of life together. And when we get them all together, it's absolutely bedlam, but a wonderful, wonderful bedlam it is. What I want to do tonight, in the next few moments, I'm very passionate about the church gathering to pray. What you're doing tonight has spiritual significance and import, perhaps beyond what you might realize. Because when the church prays, powerful things happen. God can work through our individual prayers and our personal devotions. We need time alone with God. But our time alone with God cannot replace our time gathered together as a church. And our time as a church can't replace our time alone with God. But you've chosen something that is significant, I believe, beyond what any of us realize. That when we gather together as the body of Christ, as believers, as followers of Christ, there are some things that happen. There are some dynamics that take place. Matthew chapter 18 and verse 19, Jesus said, again, I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything you ask for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. The word there, agree, we get our word symphony from it, symphoneo. What happens in a symphony is the sum is greater than the parts. When you and I gather in prayer, when you and I come together to seek the face of God as a church, what happens, or as a life group, what happens is the sum is greater than the parts. Things happen that are bigger than you and I could accomplish on our own as we seek the face of God. Moses, as he's blessing Israel in Deuteronomy chapter 32, makes his statement talking about the blessing of God's people working together and how he wished they would understand that with God's help, one person can chase 1,000, but two can chase 10,000. You see, what happens when you and I come together in the purposes of God, there is a multiplier that takes place. Our prayers are multiplied. Exponentially, things happen in the church, in our own lives, as God is working. What happens as well is as you and I are gathered together in the presence of the Lord, it draws heaven's attention. God comes near to a church that prays. And as we gather time and time and time again, there is, if you will, an accumulating grace and weight of the presence of God on that church. You've chosen something that is powerful beyond what you know. When the church prays, things happen. That's always been true. In Acts chapter 2, the church prays, the power of God descends on the place where they're praying. And when you come to Acts chapter 12, there's an incredible story of what happens when the church prays. Acts 12 gives us an example. And so in our brief time together, what I want to do is just give you three principles regarding what happens when the church gathers to pray. Number one, when the church prays, miracles happen. God does supernatural things. When you and I pray, we move from the ordinary to the extraordinary. We move from the natural to the supernatural. Watch this in Acts chapter 12, verse 1. It was about this time that King Herod, now this is not the Herod that was with baby Jesus and tried to kill him. This is that Herod's grandson. When King Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them, he had James, the brother of John, put to death with the sword. Right from the outset, in that statement, the Holy Spirit is showing us the importance of prayer. James is arrested. There's no mention of prayer on the part of the church. And James is martyred. In the verses that follow, we're going to read the story of Peter. Peter is arrested. But this time, the church realizes we better pray. And when the church prays, Peter is delivered supernaturally. All of that is a wonderful encouragement for us and a reminder that some things won't happen unless you and I pray. Don't ever make the mistake of thinking, well, if God wants it to happen, it's going to happen. That's not true. God's will is not always done. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all would come to eternal life. But some people perish, right? So we can't ever say, well, if it's God's will, it's going to happen. No, we've got to pray the will of God at times into existence. Yeah, that's right. We have to say, I so believe this is the will of God, I'm going to pray for God to do something, and the good news is he will. Yeah. Look at it in Acts 12:3. When he saw that this pleased the Jews, he proceeded to seize Peter also. This happened during the Feast of Unleavened Bread. after arresting him, he put him in prison. Verse 4 says, handing him over to be guarded by four squads of soldiers each, Herod intended to bring him out for the public trial after the Passover. So Peter was kept in prison, but look at this, but the church, unlike with James, sometimes we have to learn. I'd have been better off if I would have prayed. Sometimes as a church, we have to learn the power of prayer. You've learned that. That's why you're here. When we pray, things happen. The church was earnestly praying to God for him, fervently praying. They were with all their heart, all their soul, saying, God, we need you to do something miraculous. And when we pray like that, supernatural things begin to happen. Yep. Yeah. That's right. You say, like what? Well, in this story, we're going to see there's angels, there's miracles, there's Peter is delivered. Watch what happens here. We're going to read several verses here. The night before Herod was to bring him to trial, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and sentries stood guard at the entrance. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared, and the light shone in the cell. Why is this happening? Because there's a church praying. You see, when you and I are praying, angelic beings are working. When you and I are praying, God's doing things at that moment that are far beyond what you and I could imagine. There's supernatural activity happening because you're here that will be happening in the things that concern you and the things that are beyond you. Here they are, an angel appears, a light shines in the cell. He struck Peter on the side, woke him up. Quick, get up, he said, and the chains fell off Peter's wrists. Then the angel said to him, put on your clothes and sandals, and Peter did so. Wrap your cloak around you and follow me, the angel told him. Peter followed him out of the prison, but he had no idea that what the angel was doing was really happening. He thought he was seeing a vision. They passed through the first and second guards. So they're walking by the guards, and the guards don't even see them. Supernatural. They're invisible or the guards are blinded. Which is it? Who knows? God is working. Then it goes on and says, and they came to the iron gate leading to the city, and it opened for them by itself. Why? Because there's a church praying. Things are happening that wouldn't happen otherwise. Because we pray tonight, things are going to happen in your life in circumstances that wouldn't happen otherwise. Because you're gathered together exponentially, you're going to watch God do some things powerfully. Supernaturally incredible things are going to happen. So they go through the gate. And when they had walked the length of one street, suddenly the angel left him. Then Peter came to himself and he said, now I know without a doubt that the Lord sent his angel and rescued me from Herod's clutches and from everything the Jewish people were anticipating. When we pray, miracles happen. I don't know what miracle you need. I just know that you're in the presence of the Lord, whether you're at the Grants Mill campus or you're at one of the other Highland campuses. Right now, whatever you need, God knows what you need, and you're in the presence of the Lord, and supernatural things are going to happen. When we pray, we receive from God what only He can do. It's been very interesting. We've come through a season at James River. And when I say come through, I think we're really still at the front end. But 2 years ago in March, we started seeing amazing miracles happening in the service. So it was very interesting to watch. In the last year, just to give you an idea of the volume of it, we've had almost 1,600 documented testimonies of healing. And in the last month, to almost 200. It's like 195 testimonies of healing. And praise the Lord. That's right. He's the one who does that. You say, what kind of testimonies are you seeing? We had a 71-year-old given 6 months to live. He had ALS, completely healed. We've had multiple people who've been healed of scoliosis. We've had people with Asperger's syndrome healed instantly. People that are deaf have been healed. People that have had torn labrums, torn rotator cuffs healed. People with no ACL instantly been given a new one, gone to the doctor. The doctor said, well, you got a brand new ACL. We had an orthopedic surgeon who tore his meniscus, and he was cessationist theologically. That means they don't believe in miracles are for today. But he was at the church, and he thought, well, I'm going to give this a shot. And he was prayed for, and he felt like water was being poured down on his head. When it hit his knee, he said, instantly, I knew I had a brand new meniscus, and instantly healed. So it's people with scoliosis, people with, you know, a woman came a week ago to Sunday, had a mass. The doctors are very concerned. She'd seen them at the end of the week. They had an appointment for her on Monday to get all of the exams. They said, you need to get, we're going to get you right in. So she comes to church with the mass. She's prayed for. She goes back to her seat. The mass now is the size of a pea. And on Monday, the mass is gone. They can't find anything. So it's that kind of thing that's happening as God is touching people and healing people, and I honestly believe God wants to do that tonight. That's not the only miracle God works. The greatest miracle is when somebody comes to know Jesus. And yet at the same time, God does miracles. He's a miracle-working God, right? He's a God who's able to do what is beyond what you and I could ask or imagine. Some people will say, well, you know, prayer doesn't change things. Prayer changes us. And that's only half true. Prayer does change us, but it also changes things. Jesus said, ask and you'll receive. Seek and you'll find. Knock and the door will be opened unto you. James says, you have not because you ask not. And when the church gathers together to pray, the presence of the Lord is here in a unique and a powerful way, and the result is miracles happen. Peter, in this case, is set free. Watch what happens, verse 12. Very interesting. When this had dawned on him, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, also called Mark, where many people had gathered and were praying. There it is again. It's as if Luke wants us to know and the Holy Spirit wants us to know that when you and I gather to pray, things happen that are powerful, things happen that are unexpected, things happen that are supernatural. Peter knocked at the outer entrance, and a servant girl named Rhoda came to answer the door. When she recognized Peter's voice, she was so overjoyed, she ran back without opening it and exclaimed, Peter is at the door. You're out of your mind, they told her. Now, what is it they were praying for? For Peter to be delivered. What is the prayer God answered? Peter's deliverance. What is their response? I can't believe it. Sometimes that's so like us. We pray prayers and really aren't sure that God is going to answer them. But when we're in the presence of the Lord and when we as a church are praying, God is going to do things supernaturally, powerfully, miraculously in our lives. Listen, I hope you understand, you were made as a follower of Christ for answered prayer. Come on. Jesus said this, ask, John 16:24, and he several times in that discourse talks about asking. Ask and you'll receive, listen to this, that your joy may be full. Yeah. That you would have joy. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Where does that come from the believer? Part of it is the work of the Holy Spirit through the fruit of the Spirit. Part of it is through seeing God answer prayer and the privilege of seeing His will come to pass, not only in our own life, but in the lives of others and in the kingdom at large as God does impossible things. And we look at it and we say, only God could do that. I mean, I hope when you walk over there at the Highlands College campus, I hope in your heart you realize this isn't the work of man, though God uses people. This is the hand of God. This is God doing something supernatural. This is God miraculously setting his hand on Highlands Church to bring about this beautiful campus of Highlands College. It's another testimony. When you see it, remind yourself, he's a God who does miracles. He is a miracle-working God in every way. Verse 16 says, Peter kept on knocking, and when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. When we as a church pray, miracles happen. Things happen that wouldn't happen otherwise. God's power is released. The supernatural takes place. Anytime you come, and this is why being at First Wednesday is so important. When Pastor Blake says to this campus, don't miss it. You want to do whatever you have to do to be here. He's right. At every other campus, you want to do whatever it takes. And not only to bring yourself, but be telling your small group about it. Be telling your friends about it. Be inviting people to come. Because what happens in here when God's people pray is extraordinary. So God does miracles when the church prays. Number two, when the church prays, God does more than we ask. Here's one of the mysteries of prayer, that as we're praying, God works through our prayers in a way that goes way beyond our prayers. He does more. I mean, think of it this way. Jesus taught us to pray in the Lord's Prayer. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. God's will is so big, so far beyond our understanding, so far reaching, that the power of our prayers extends beyond what we ask because of his will. Here's what Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 3. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. So we're asking, but he's doing immeasurably more. We're imagining, but there's nothing too hard for God, right? So when God is at work in a place, when a church is praying, God does more than you or I would ask. Now here's what's interesting in Acts chapter 12, because it addresses that in the chapter. In Acts chapter 12, the chapter begins with the mention of King Herod, and it ends with the mention of King Herod. Look at it. I'll bring it up here on the screen. It was about this time that King Herod arrested some people who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. Look at it in verse 23. Immediately, because Herod did not give praise to God, an angel of the Lord struck him down, and he was eaten by worms and died. He was a problem for the church at the start of the chapter, but at the end of the chapter, he's gone. What's in the heart of the chapter? The church is praying. Did the church pray for that to happen? We have no record that they did. But what happens is, as they're praying, God does more than they asked. God did things they hadn't even thought of. When we pray as a church, God does more than we ask, because there are some things we don't even know we should be asking that we need, right? And God says, because their hearts turned toward me, I'm going to take care of the things they haven't even thought about. It's Matthew 6:33. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto you, right? Amen. That when you and I pray about the things that concern him, he takes care of all the things that concern us, even the things we've never thought about that we need his help with. And all of us have bazillion things we need God to help us with that we didn't even know we needed his help on. When we pray, God does more than we ask. When we pray, miracles happen. Let me give you one more. When we pray, when the church prays, it increases God's word. Look at it, Acts 12:24. But the word of God increased and multiplied. Now, most people take that statement as, well, that's church growth. I mean, the church grew. I think certainly that is part of it, But that's not exactly what it says. It says the word of God increased. It says the word of God multiplied. Here's a leadership principle that has really helped me through the years. People will never share your heart until you pray with them. If you want to get two people on the same page, pray. If you want to get your spouse on the same page, pray. The couple that prays together is going to be more united than the couple that doesn't. I'm just telling you, that is true, true, true. Some of you, you're married, you're not praying together. You're missing one of the greatest opportunities, not only for unity, but for intimacy as you pray together. You say, well, I'm not sure they want to, or I'm not sure. Listen, you know what? It can be as simple as you want to make it, but it will unite your hearts together in a way nothing else will. You want your family to be united, pray together. Yeah. You want your kids to share your heart? Teach them to pray. Let them hear you pray. Pray together. You want your, at work, if you have the opportunity, maybe you're a leader, pray. Watch what God does in bringing people's hearts together when they pray. Now, when you and I are in the presence of God, what happens when we're praying, His heart becomes more real to us, right? Suddenly, we're sharing His heart. Suddenly, the things, because you're in His presence, what's going to happen is, as you go out of this place, God's will, God's direction, God's voice, you're going to hear His voice more loudly. You're going to hear it with greater clarity because you've been in His presence. What's going to happen as well is, as you're hearing His word in His presence, if prayer causes the word of God to increase and multiply, it causes faith to increase and multiply.
Yeah, that's right.
How is that? Because faith comes from hearing and hearing from the word of God. So if the word of God is getting big in you, faith is going to get big in you.
Right.
It's going to strengthen you to believe God for the things, the challenges, the situations, the circumstances that all of us face in life. When you and I are spending time in prayer, what happens is God's word begins to grow in us. Our understanding of His word grows. I mean, have you ever read a passage like, I don't get it, I don't even understand it, and next thing you know, you say, I'm going to pray, Lord, just help me to understand this. And then maybe somebody comes along, or maybe you're in small group, or maybe you're listening to Pastor Chris, and all of a sudden that passage you didn't understand, that concept, all of a sudden it explodes in your mind because you've been praying and now the word of God increases in you. And it changes your life as the voice of God becomes more loud and more clear in your life. And it then leads us in the priorities of Christ. Listen, when we pray, and I'm going to ask the musicians to come right now, when we pray, powerful things happen. God wants to do powerful things in your life tonight. Some of you have situations and you're like, I don't know what to do. God does. I don't know how it could work out. God does. I don't think I can do it. He can help you do it. And if you can't do it, He can do it for you. I mean, there's just so many ways God can work in things that go beyond our imagination. And tonight is a night at every single campus for people to receive supernatural answers to human problems that defy our ability to solve them. This is why I love the prayer meeting. Because in the prayer meeting, God changes us. You can be different tomorrow morning. I can tell you that. From being in the presence of, you're going to get up tomorrow morning and you're going to sense the presence of God on your life. If you're sensitive at all, you'll say, wow, I sense God. And it's going to dawn on you, well, I was in His presence last night. For some of you, I mean, I love this verse. It's in Song of Solomon. My body is asleep, but my heart is awake. God walks the sleep lanes of our life. He speaks to us, He encourages us, He strengthens us. But I just am praying for the church. I talked with Pastor Chris and then just am praying for the church. Because I asked him, how can I help you? He said, you just do what you do. And right now, we're just seeing God work in some unique ways.
And part of that comes through words of knowledge and in praying for the church. I just feel God wants to heal people at all of the campuses. So as I mention a need, if that's you, I would just ask you to stand, whether you're here at this campus or any one of the campuses. I'm gonna ask you to be bold enough to stand. You say, why? Because there's something about that exercise of faith that God honors, right? And so tonight, just a few things I feel God wants to do in the way of healing people. If you could sit first, and then I'm gonna call some things, and we wanna pray specifically for those, and then we're gonna pray for minister to even more people. If there's somebody that you've got pain in your back, it's in the L5 nerve, and it's causing the L5 vertebrae, and it's causing nerve pain down your leg, and it's at times excruciating, and they're not able to help you. If that's you, would you stand? If that's you, I'm asking you to stand and remain standing. God wants to heal you tonight. Somebody here and you have an ovarian cyst, or at any of the campuses, when I say here, I'm speaking Highlands First Wednesday prayer meeting. And if that's you, would you stand? God's going to heal you tonight. Somebody here, and maybe more than one, and you have scoliosis. We have seen probably 50 people with curved spines straightened in Jesus' name. If that's you, would you stand? At any of the campuses, you have scoliosis. One last one. There's somebody here, and in a car accident, you experienced a brain injury, and there's nothing the doctors can do. God's gonna heal you tonight. If that's you, stand, would you please? Now I'm gonna ask you to do this. If you're standing, I'm gonna ask you to step in the aisle, if you would, because we're gonna pray for you. So step into the aisle, because there's a power when believers pray. Remember the agreement? It's like a symphony. The sum is greater than the parts. So I'm gonna ask you to step into the aisle there. And if we could if there's people around you, step forward or step back so we can get people around you. And then what I would like you to do is in just a minute, I'm gonna release you to pray for people. But what I would like you to do is when I release the people to pray and you're in the aisle, you'd lift your hand so we can just make sure we're getting to everybody. But then when you're going up to pray, would you just ask them, what is it? Which one are you? Are you the scoliosis? Are you the nerve pain? Are you the ovarian cyst? Are you the brain injury? Just ask. And then would you begin to just pray and say, Lord, you want to heal tonight in the name of Jesus. Heal. And just declare healing over that sickness. Okay? Let's do that. Would you gather around these people? Let's stand right now. Just gather around them. If you're standing for healing in the aisle, lift your hands so we get people around. And then what I want you to do, just begin to lay hands on them. You can't get near somebody, stretch out your hands. We're all part of this. We're all part of this magnificent symphony agreeing in prayer for healing right now. At every campus, would you do that? Just gather around them and begin to pray. We're gonna call on God. You pray. You ask God to heal. And then after a season, I'll lead out in prayer. Father, we thank you tonight for your healing power. Lord, you are visiting the campuses of Highland Church tonight, Church of the Highlands. You're visiting with your healing power. At every campus, Lord, you're there. And Lord, we're laying hands on those who have needs. Tonight we ask you, oh God, in the name of Jesus, May you touch L5. May you touch the nerve and the vertebrae. And Lord, may you bring wholeness and healing. I pray, Lord, there would be a relief of pain in Jesus' name. Lord, that what's wrong in structurally, Lord, you would heal it in the name of Jesus. Father, we pray for that ovarian cyst. In Jesus' name, be gone. Be healed in the name of Jesus. Father, we pray for that curved spine. In the name of Jesus, may you touch ligaments and muscles and nerves and bones. And where there was a curve that is not right, that is causing the scoliosis, oh Lord, may you bring healing. May you straighten that spine in the name of Jesus. Be healed. Spine be straight. Father, we pray for the brain injury. You are a divine physician. You're Jehovah Rapha. You're the God who heals. And so, God, we ask in the name of Jesus that, Lord, you'd bring healing. You'd make that brain whole. Father, that you would touch them in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Come on, let's put our hands together. Let's bless the Lord. Lord, we thank you. Now, let me just say this to all of those who are prayed for. So the way we've seen this work, I mean, people are healed instantly. Some people feel heat, some people don't feel anything. It doesn't matter what you feel, it matters what God does. So you can't go off any feeling. We've had people who had legs longer because of surgery. They had a knee replacement, their leg was longer, and God made their legs the same length. In the service, they didn't feel a thing. Other people feel it. So, you know, what you want to do is you want to rest in the fact God has healed you. Some people get up the next morning and they're healed. So the man with ALS, he was prayed for on a Wednesday night. He wasn't healed, but he got up the next morning, and all of a sudden it dawned on him, he could walk across the room. He walked across the room. Then he said, well, I wonder if I can make it to the kitchen, and if I can, I'm going to grab a water bottle, because he couldn't open a water bottle, and he couldn't drink without spilling down his front. And he got over to the kitchen. He opened a water bottle. His hand was strong like it had never been. He began to drink, and none of it spilled, and he knew instantly he was healed. A couple days later, he's out mowing his grass. His neighbors were just shocked. They were like, what in the world are you doing? He said, I was dead, but now I am alive. Jesus is here. So, all that to say, you don't want to conclude what's happened in this moment. You want to say, hey, listen, God called out my condition, and I was prayed for, and if you don't, I think a person's better say, you know, he hasn't healed me yet. If you want to say that, I just say, he's healing me. He's healing me. The person with Parkinson's had two doctors, a severe case of Parkinson's. Between Sunday and Friday, every day they were better until Friday. The tremors were completely gone. The Parkinson's is completely gone. They were whole. All I'm saying is, you heal some instantly, some gradually. I can't figure it out. That's way above my pay grade. I just know he heals, okay? So I just want to encourage you with that at all the campuses. Now what I'd like to do is I'd like to ask the campus pastors, the prayer teams, to come down front, because everybody else, God wants to heal you. He wants to help you. The presence of the Lord is here. You can feel his presence here. And I can sense faith in your heart tonight. So I don't know what you need. At any campus, God is here. He's here to touch you. I can just tell you this. I wouldn't sit back. I wouldn't worry about, some people say, well, I'm just not sure I deserve it. Listen, it's not about what we deserve. If we go off that basis, we're all in trouble. But it's about his great love for you. He loves you. He wants to help you with whatever you need. So would you allow the people to pray for you? And we're just going to be in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Come on, you come forward.